bring strength within our soul to know that you've given us the gifts at the cross.
Okay.
I have heard these babies.
Some of these are in here, but I'm looking up.
Oh, see, he's got something right there.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to need Jesus.
Start off tonight with Mansion Over the Hilltop. It's not in the hymn book, so don't bother looking in there.
We playing in
that's in G. Yeah.
G, okay.
At least that's what that, I think that's what it says.
Yeah, what it says.
Yeah, in G. I'm sad. Boy, that's low now. Let's take that up to A. That's just so low, I don't think we can do it that way.
I'm satisfied just to college people.
Silver line, I've got a man.
trying to see what the number that was, that 320.
329.
329. You want to see?
Back.
I guess maybe I'll put my glasses on and turn to it in my book in case. I am having a little fun seeing those words back there. And it does that say the key of F, it looks like. So I'm just wondering. I think we're going to do it in D, because I'm in D.
Okay.
And I don't know if we can sing another F. That'd be,
okay.
That'd be up here. Marvelous. Yeah, I think D sounds better.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount, how poor, there the blood of lambs was spilled.
Good thing I'm not doing an eye test without my glasses. Glasses don't do me any good for a distance. So I would fail that eye test, wouldn't I? Okay. Let's see, now that is in. Yeah, I guess we would do it in D since it's in flat.
Yeah.
Well, it's not really a special. I like to consider it a special because I don't have a good voice. I like to lead the crowd and let you all help me. Is there anybody who want to volunteer to help me today? Sam, well, come on up if you want to. I'm going to teach you a chorus. We'll go through it twice, a chorus, and then I'll sing the verses, and you just help me on the chorus. Is that okay? Okay. You sure you don't want to come up and help me? All right. This is one where you need to, instead of clapping me, just a little bit rocking back and forth, maybe? Yeah, can you do that? Okay, it's in D. The only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. The only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. With all life's frustrations, I need you, and I know I do. 'Cause the only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. Okay, one more time, just a chorus. The only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. The only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. With all life's frustrations, I need you, and I know I do. 'Cause the only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. Here you go, back and forth. Now I get the verse now. Life is a few days of trouble, a wise man once said. But I'll not complain, for I'm sheltered, I'm clothed, and I'm fed. Many the trials and my wants and my dreams put me through. And the only real peace that I have, the Lord, is in you. Here we go, help me now. The only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. The only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. With all life's frustrations, I need you, and I know I do. 'Cause the only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. The higher I soar in my dreams, the harder I fall. And sometimes I wonder if dreams are worth dreaming at all. But all my disappointments won't keep me binded in blue. Oh, when I'm reminded of the sweet peace I have, Lord, in you. Hey, help me out now. Back and forth. There we go. The only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. The only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. With all life's frustrations, I need you, and I know I do. 'Cause the only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. One more time. The only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. The only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. With all life's frustrations, I need you, and I know I do. 'Cause the only real peace that I have, dear Lord, is in you. I really would have confused you if you had to lean the same way I did. I'm going to go opposite way. Okay.
Just in case you know so that, I know that song, and if you know, if you've heard it before, is the Hemp Hills. I'm trying to remember the father's of the Hemp Hill's name, Candy Hemp Hill's dad. He wrote the song just tremendous. He wrote a lot of songs. Good one to have, and thank you, Daryl.
Thank you, Daryl. Yeah. You want to turn to Luke chapter 8? Luke chapter 8 tonight, I'll probably. I used to tease him. I'd say, well, you know what? I did exercise today. And he'd look at me and be like, well, that's good. I said, yeah, I exercised my faith. And he'd look at me and he'd kind of, and I'd say, I exercised my faith and I know one thing's for sure. This old body ain't going to be the one that I have in eternity because he's giving me a new one. So there's my exercise for the day. But at any rate, we do exercise faith all day. When you walked into this church and you sat down in that pew, you exercise faith. Nobody here. Yeah, I know. That's 2 weeks in a row. That's unlike me.
Anyway, I digress. But anyway, when you came in, you sat down in that pew. You didn't do all the calculations to see how thick the wood was, how many supports were underneath it, and all that other good stuff, how much each person in that pew weighed, and then decided whether you were going to sit down and it supports you or not. You just sat down and had faith that it would hold you. Same thing with your car. When you got in your car, you probably exercised faith that when you turned that key, it was going to start and get you to church. You also probably was pretty sure that somebody be here to give you a message of the Lord Jesus Christ in this church. So you exercise faith when you came here expecting a sermon. You see, everybody has faith in something, ladies and gentlemen. But Jesus Christ asked a question to his disciples here in this text that we're going to get to. He says, where is your faith? You see, Jesus encouraged people to have great faith in God, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit and His Word. He taught people to have faith by means of the miraculous words that He spoke. He said, my words are truth. You can believe in those. You can have faith in that. You can trust in it with all your might and all your heart. He encouraged even greater faith by the miraculous works that He did, that He performed for those people. You know, I can only imagine, I don't understand how people could be so hard-hearted as some of those Pharisees and Sadducees not to have belief in the Lord Jesus Christ after all the miracles that they heard and they saw Him and were attested to, the signs and the wonders. And He sought to instill faith by the remarkable life that He lived. I mean, how could you look at somebody that has lived a life without any sin and not say, wow, I need to have faith in that person? The next thing is Jesus demonstrated His faith by dying on that cross. He demonstrated, ladies and gentlemen, He expressed His confidence at that point in time that the Father would raise Him from the dead and that His sinless sacrifice, His shed blood, would be good enough to redeem all those who would come to Him in repentance and ask for forgiveness. Beloved, we live in a time that emphasizes faith in oneself. That's a real dangerous place to be. We believe in ourselves. We're told that that believing in ourselves can help us to achieve our goals, that it can manifest our dreams. I mean, how many times has somebody said, you can be anything you want to be? Well, I'm sorry. There are some things that I ain't going to be, and I know it. And I don't even aspire to it. One is one that I never thought would happen. I never thought somebody would tell me I could aspire to be a female and be a female. Because that one ain't going to happen. Well, thank you, Daryl. And if we do have faith in ourselves, it will increase our own well-being. Amen? It's what the love's telling us. But beloved, anytime we put our faith in ourselves or man, we are on shaky ground, okay? It is not a firm foundation to be. For we truly have no power in and of ourselves. None. None whatsoever. You may think that you do. You may be able to get through this life in some kind of way and powering your way through and doing it your way. But when it comes right down to it, every breath you take is because of the Lord. Every heartbeat that you have is because of the Lord. And every day that you get is a blessing from the Lord. Every hour, every minute, every little tick, every little heartbeat is from the Lord. And people need to recognize that. You know, Michelangelo got it wrong. He's got a famous quote. I don't know if any of you know this. But Michelangelo said, "Faith in myself is the best and safest course." I hope he didn't have that kind of faith when he went into eternity, ladies and gentlemen, because I know if that was the kind of thing that he really truly thought, we ain't going to see Michelangelo in heaven, amen? Mm-hmm. An emphasis today is put on what? Faith in material worth, material resources. You know, but you think about it, listen to all the natural disasters that are going on. It isn't going to be long that all those material resources are going to be gone. The insurance companies aren't going to be able to cover the cost of the lost. And eventually the government will probably step in and say, hey, we're the big savior, and they'll make us pay for it with our tax dollars one way or the other and try and get through it. But eventually that'll run dry too, because the Lord can make, if we don't turn to Him, the Lord can make a whole lot more natural disasters than we can rebuild. They also look for science for solutions. They look for faith in it to cure diseases and climate. Look what we went through with COVID. They said we're going to have a vaccine. You take the vaccine and you still get the COVID. They keep telling us that climate changed, and they go on data that's only 100 years old. They have no idea what the climate was when Adam and Eve were around. Well, I can tell you what the climate was. It was real nice outside. And the other thing that I can tell you too is if God wants to change science, guess what? He can change science. I saw an article on my phone coming up when I went through. I didn't even bother to read it, but one of the scientists is saying, the poles are getting ready to flip. The South Pole is going to become the North Pole, and the North Pole is going to become the South Pole. I thought, well, if the Lord wants it to become the North and South Pole, and He wants to switch them, He can. I'm not sure it's going to make much difference for you and I, other than our toilet bowl might spin the other way. For those of you that don't know, it spins the opposite direction under the equator. That's your tidbit for the day. Others often put faith in yourself, their own way of thinking. There is a way, it says in Scripture, that seems right unto a man, but it is the way of death, especially with salvation. Most people think that they might be able to get into heaven on their own good merit, and that's just not the case. Beloved, people always experience disappointment when they place confidence that they should have reserved only for God in something other than God. So if you're able, please stand with me for the reading of God's Word. We're going to put in at Luke chapter 8. We're going to read verses 20 through to 25. The Word of the Lord. Now it happened on a certain day that He got into a boat with His disciples. And He said to them, "Let us cross over to the other side of the lake." And they launched out. But as they sailed, He fell asleep. And a windstorm came down on the lake, and they were filling with water and were in jeopardy. And they came to Him and awoke Him, saying, "Master, Master, we are perishing." Then He arose and rebuked the wind and the raging of the water. And they ceased, and there was a calm. But He said to them, "Where is your faith?" And they were afraid and marveled, saying to one another, "Who can this be? For He commands even the winds and the water, and they obey Him." Let us pray. Dear God, may we always know that You are Master, that You are ruling and reigning, and Lord, that we can trust in You and that we need to have faith in everything You say and everything that You do. Lord, we know that You have a plan and purpose for this world. We know You have a plan and purpose for each person here. Just let us exercise the faith to believe that You know what You're doing and that You're always right in that. And Lord, we just thank You. We thank You for this word. Lord, for we know that the grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of the Lord stands forever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Well, we're going to look at a few things we shouldn't do with our faith, and then we're going to look at how we need to grow our faith. The first thing that we need to be aware of is a misplaced faith is a troubling sin of us all. We often all, at one point in time or another, maybe place our faith in something other than God, and whether it be in ourselves. I know oftentimes that's one of my greatest sins, is I often start doing things in my own power rather than in the power of God. We have a tendency to forget God, and then we become overwhelmed with the difficulties of this life, don't we? We see that happening with so many people. We take our eyes off the Lord and off His power and His wisdom and discernment, and we do what? We become fixed on the problem rather than on the solution. And I'm going to tell you right here and now, God has a solution, ladies and gentlemen. And He's working all things out to His glory and to your good for all those who love God. You see, the problem is, ladies and gentlemen, when we often get in problems, we continue to look horizontally. We look at this world. We look for man. We look for the bank. We look for the government to solve our problems instead of looking vertically. And God says we need to look vertically and quit looking horizontally. If we just quit looking horizontally altogether, as a church, as a nation, as individuals, we'd be so much better off. I can only imagine how the Lord would honor if we finally just got to the place where we put our total trust and faith in Him. You see, God is a good God. God is a God of 1,000 cattle on a hill. God is a God who has a heavenly host that surrounds us. He's a God that produced manna from heaven when they needed food. He's the God that when a prophet, widow, and a son only had a little jar of flour and a little bit of oil, He fed them for 3 years. We need to have faith that He can take care of us and what's going on down here in this world. You see, beloved, even believers at times put confidence in material possessions. Oftentimes we put it into our military power and might of what's going on in the world, or we put it into human ingenuity. Faithlessness in His people is a problem in the Lord's eye. First thing we want to look at is faithlessness was the undoing sin of the ancient Israelites. We look back, we look in when they got into the wilderness. As we talked about before, about seeing Jesus' miracles, how people didn't believe with all the wonderful works, signs and wonders He did, and giving the truth in His word, and then dying on a cross and being rose again. But how those people in Egypt, they could come out of Egypt, see the power, the signs and the wonders that God did, and yet still not believe that God could get them into the promised land. We're afraid of a few giants. When He had wiped out the whole Egyptian army. When He had already parted the sea and they saw it, and they crossed it on dry land. You see, God would help them take that promised land if they had just had faith. But that lack of faith, ladies and gentlemen, cost them what? Cost them the opportunity to see the promised land, didn't it? Each and every person that said, hey, we can't go. There was only two that made it into the promised land. It's the two spies that said that we can take that land and had faith in God. The rest of them perished in that land. You see, faithlessness, it caused Israel not to be able to get into the promised land. Faithlessness caused Israel, even when it did get in the promised land, to turn away from God. They didn't believe God. They didn't take Him at His word that He would take care of them. They saw the pagans around them. They saw some of the great things that they had. And they started wanting those same resources. They started all of those things that the pagans and the pagan gods around them, they started to practice those things. One of the reasons that God gave them a king was because they wanted a king like everybody else. And they rejected God as their king and their master. You see, they didn't take God at His word. They didn't follow His word because He says, if they had followed His word, they would be blessed. But if they didn't, they would be cursed. And we all know what's going on in that land right now, don't we? Next, the lack of faith was the sin that plagued the disciples. It hindered them from being a channel of God's power at times. We look back to Matthew 16. It's the leaven of the Pharisees. Jesus was talking about how those Pharisees, you know, He said that you need to watch out for the leaven, and they thought they were talking about bread, that they hadn't bought enough bread. But then Jesus said, really? Did you forget the 5,000 that we just fed? Bread's not a real problem for me. Neither are fish. I got plenty of them. What you need to be worried about is your soul. And what you're putting into your body that's keeping it from coming to the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, not the Lord, yeah, the Lord Jesus Christ. Not to be worried about your physical food, but seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added to you. In Matthew chapter 17, if you like, you can turn with me there. I'm going to put in at verse 14, Matthew 17. This is about the boy that had been healed and how the disciples were plagued from channels of God's blessing. It says, and when they had come to the multitude, a man came to him, kneeling down to him and saying, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is an epileptic and suffers severely, for he often falls into the fire and often into the water. So they brought him to your disciples, but they could not cure him. Then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him here to me. And Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of him, and the child was cured from that very hour. Then the disciples came to Jesus privately and said, Why could we not cast him out? So Jesus said to them, Because of your unbelief. For surely I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, Move from here to there. And it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. However, this kind does not come out except with prayer and fasting. You see, beloved, sometimes we don't get God's full blessings because we aren't faithful in what we're doing. We miss a blessing. Those disciples, if they'd had real faith that they could get that demon out of there and in the power of the God, and would have had the prayer and fasting that Jesus Christ talked about, they would have had the blessing of seeing the power of God work through them to bring that demon out of that boy. He had given that power before, hadn't he? They had done it and they had walked around. The next thing is faithlessness deprives the church today of spiritual power and significant achievements. I want to ask you a question. Why we don't share the gospel and see more people saved? Why don't we do that? It's faithlessness. It really is. That's what it boils down to. Do we really believe that Jesus saves? And do we really believe that God told us to go out and preach the gospel, didn't he? He's given us the power to preach the gospel and to get out. And in that power, he wants to use us as a conduit to change lives and to bring people to him and to bring people to repentance. You see, we might share the gospel here and there, ladies and gentlemen, and when it doesn't have an immediate result, what do? We lack faith. We lack faith that it works. We want to share and have the easy button. We want it to happen right now. That, most of the time, I'm going to tell you, does not happen. It does take a while. You know, the average person, I read one time in a study, it takes at least 7 times for them. To hear the gospel before they even really start to comprehend what it's about. So if we aren't out there sharing the gospel, people aren't hearing it, so they aren't really processing it. They're not meditating on it. And we need to have the faith, ladies and gentlemen, to go out and share that gospel. You know what really just amazes me when people don't share the gospel of Jesus Christ when they're born-again believers? If you're a true born-again believer, you know that Jesus saves. Because you've been saved. And somewhere you heard the gospel and came to that conclusion. So why we as born-again believers don't think that giving the gospel out into the world saves? Well, Jesus saves, but we tell them we're the conduit that tells them that. And we need to make sure that we're out there preaching that gospel because as born-again believers, we know that Jesus saves. And we know that preaching the gospel works because we came to the conclusion that we needed Jesus as our Lord and Savior and that we were the sinners that He says we were. Next, it is the sin of faithlessness that causes the unsaved to remain lost and separated from God. John 3:18 says, He who believes in Him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. John 3:36 says, He who believes in the Son has everlasting life. And he who does not believe in the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. Beloved, they don't believe God. And God says they're without excuse. The book of Romans chapter 1 is very, very clear that we ought to know that there is a God just by looking out into creation. Now, how in the world you can look at a person and not say that there isn't a creator? That somehow it came from some kind of an amoeba or a process or evolution. Just ain't going to happen. I don't know about you. I've been on this earth for 61 years. Some of you have been here longer than that. But you really have never, other than somebody that's changed by Jesus Christ, you've never seen anything evolve, have you? Not from what it originally was. And one of the things that I'm sure of is if you get Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are going to be transformed. You will turn into a new person. So the quickest way to become a new person is to be in Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
And we need to make sure that the lost hear that, because they are separated from God, and their lack of faith in Him does that. The next thing is there's tragic results of little or a misplaced faith in God. You know, it's very clear in Hebrews 11:6, without faith it is impossible for us to please God. Hebrews 11:6 says, but without faith it is impossible to please Him, for he who comes to God must believe that He is, and He is rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. He who comes to God must believe that He is. You think about that statement. We kind of oftentimes, if you gloss over that real quickly, you don't necessarily get it. But you know, there's people right now who are out there who says, he who comes to God must believe that He is. But they're not believing in the one true living God, are they? They're believing in some other God. So God's making sure that we know that we come to the one true living God and that He is the rewarder. You are not going to be rewarded with saving grace. You are not going to be rewarded with eternal life unless you come to the one true living God, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. It has to be done through Him. The next thing is without faith, imaginary dangers darken our pathways. How many of you ever came home from work one night and you knew what was coming the next day, or things didn't go right and you worried all night about what was going to happen? I think we've all done that, haven't we? What's that next day going to bring? Well, beloved, that's a lack of faith on our part. You see, we often get to the place where we think of the worst case scenario, and you and I forget who's walking with us through the valley of the shadow of death, don't we? And the one that seeks to keep us from all alarms. You see, He is able to help us to the utmost. He is able to calm our soul and our spirit. He is able to take care of the problem. I don't know how many times I lost sleep over a problem at work, got there the next day and realized, you know what, Lord, that was stupid. I sure lost a lot of sleep over nothing. And without faith, prayer is an undiscovered privilege. You see, Christ opened up the throne room to us, ladies and gentlemen. We ought to go there. I know one thing's for sure. If they opened up probably, well, I don't know now, some of you, you may not want to go see who it is, but if they opened up the White House and dinner every night to you there, you might want to go. I know if they opened up the throne room, which God has, we walk by faith and not by sight, and I can't wait to see that throne room one day in heaven. Amen. Going to be a wonderful thing, but you can go there right now because Christ, where the veil was torn, He paid the price. You can't take it any higher than that, ladies and gentlemen. And without faith, prayer is an undiscovered privilege. You have the privilege of being able to go there as a born-again believer. Philippians 4:6 says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. You see, the key to that there in Philippians 4:6 is that thanksgiving. It says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. Thank God right away. He wants to and is going to answer your prayer. And I'm going to tell you what, it may not necessarily be the answer you want, but it's going to be the right answer. And you need to thank Him for that. I'm not big on secular music sometimes, but you know, Garth Brooks may have had it right once. Thank God for unanswered prayer sometimes, because sometimes we don't ask for the right thing, amen?
Amen?
Or in the right way. The next thing is without service for God, without faith, service for God appears to be an impossible task, and that is, ladies and gentlemen, absolutely true. I've told you before, when you called me at pastor, it was one of the scariest things I've ever had to do. Because God's asking me to do something I've never done and asked me to be entrusted to do something I never have done, and that's take care of a flock.
Amen.
And no matter how much training you have to have faith in the Lord to help you through it. Those He calls, He does equip. I don't care if He's called you to take out the trash, He will equip you to do it and give you a blessing for it if that's what He's calling you for. I never in my life would have believed that He would have called me to pastor a church for the first half of my life. But Brother Winston gave me a piece of advice. He said, hang on, brother. Hang on for the ride. Just let the Lord have the wheel and keep on going. Mark 10:27 says, but Jesus looked at them and said, with men it is impossible, but not with God. For God all things are possible. Beloved, He was talking about salvation there. None of us can procure our own salvation, but with God it is possible. And we know it because we have our Lord and Savior who died for our sins, according to the Scripture, was buried, and He rose again on the third day, according to the Scriptures. But it's also true with so many other things in our lives. Things may be impossible with us, but they are possible with God. We need to hold that in our heart. Salvation is possible. But the other thing that's possible for you, you think, man, I could never change. Well, you need to have faith, because the sanctification process is the same thing. It's possible with God. He can change you. He can change your heart. He can change the vilest heart if He wants to, for those who come to Him. The third thing is misplaced faith grieves the heart of God. One of the things that misplaced faith does is it disappoints His love. Misplaced faith reveals to God your lack of faith in the Almighty. You're really saying, you know, you don't love Him enough to do what He says. It reveals, God, your lack of faith in the Almighty. That you love what? You love some other person, some other place, or some other thing more than Him. And that's what it says. He says, trust and believe in Me with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and with all your strength. It says in our Scripture to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, and with all your spirit. And Jesus said, if you love Me, you'll do what? You'll obey My commandments, right? So it disappoints His love when we don't obey Him and we have a lack of faith in it. Proverbs 3:5-6 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him and He shall direct your paths. Part of the problem that we have, Lord, is the misplaced trust sometimes, and that we want to direct our own paths, right? And we need to make sure that we're not disappointing His love and doing His will and following His path. A misplaced faith also grieves the heart of God in the fact that it questions His power. He has power over everything seen and unseen, ladies and gentlemen. He is the Master. We just read in our text that He had power over what? Wind and wave. Well, if that wasn't something to behold, how about power over sin and death? That's even greater yet, isn't it? And I can't wait for the day that there's no more sin, no more tears, and no more death. That is going to be a wonderful day, ladies and gentlemen. And I can't wait to see it. And the other thing, too, is really we should not wait to tell people about it. You know, you think about it for just a little while, what the kind of hope that people can have. There is such hopelessness out there in this world right now. And people are wondering what to believe in and what the truth is, and we have the opportunity to tell them, ladies and gentlemen. And we have the opportunity to tell them that we know the One that has the power to change it all. We have the opportunity to tell the people who has victory over sin and death. We have the power to tell them that one day all will may be made right by our Lord and our Savior. Amen. You see, when we lack faith to spread the gospel, we're saying that He doesn't have the power to save. That's really what we're saying in our hearts when it comes right down to it. And we all know Jesus saves. And that's a dangerous, dangerous place for us to be when we've been told to go out and share the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because He wants us to bestow His power on others. So ladies and gentlemen, oftentimes we miss blessings by not having faith. You know, one of the things I can almost guarantee you, one of the things that you'll be pleasantly surprised about, is if you go out and you share the gospel of Jesus Christ, and I don't care if every time you went out and you shared the gospel of Jesus Christ, and every time you went out that person rejected you, every person that you ever gave it to. But we shouldn't be so short-sighted. But you know why? Because you were faithful. And in that faithfulness, you know what I believe? And I believe Scripture bears this out, that when you get to heaven, you're going to see a lot of people you shared the gospel with that you didn't know came to the saving grace of Jesus Christ. Because He has the power to save. And the fact that you have been faithful in doing your part, He will honor that. When we lack faithfulness, it also hinders His purpose. When Jesus visited His hometown of Nazareth, He was unable to do what? Any of the mighty works. It's because of why? Because of the residents' unbelief. You see, that is the weakness of today's church. We have a faithlessness. We are hindering Christ's ability to save people because we're not sharing the gospel, because we're not bringing people in. We're not making disciples. You know, oftentimes there's people that come in and they're converts is what they are. They're not really true followers. They want fire insurance. But we need to make sure that people have a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. That they know what true biblical repentance is and what true salvation is. That it's not just saying, "Dear Lord, forgive me for my sins. I'm so sorry. Thank you so much for dying on a cross for me. Amen." And then turning around the next day and living their life just exactly as they had the day that they said the prayer. You see, He's called us to be disciples, ladies and gentlemen. He's called us to spread the gospel. So, now how about some answers for growing a great faith? Let's look at what God says about that now that we know what faithlessness does. First of all, if you want to grow your faith, make faith a matter of prayer. You need to join the apostles. In Luke 17, 5, what did they ask Jesus to do? Increase their faith, didn't they? They said, increase our faith. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to tell you something right here now. I would encourage you to pray that exact prayer, but you better be ready and you better hold on, okay? Because if you're earnest in that prayer and you really want your faith increased, you better be ready. Because why? Well, He just might send you out into this world without any money. He might tell you there's a place for you to stay, but you're not going to the Motel 6. You stay wherever you come to and they accept your word. That'd be a kind of a scary thing out there in this world right now, wouldn't it? To go out with the gospel of Jesus Christ and only stay where they accept your word. Or maybe He'll go out and tell you to do something that you've had a hard time doing all your life, is to preach the gospel. Like I said, if you ask to increase your faith, you better be ready. He may also take some things away from you that you have faith in that are keeping you from Him. But I'll tell you what, you'll be a whole lot better off if He takes every one of those things away from you and you learn to rely on Him. Amen. The next thing is to study God's Word to increase your faith. Romans 10:17 says, "So faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God." I believe, if I'm correct, I heard this, it's about Billy Sunday. For those of you who may not know who Billy Sunday is, he was a professional baseball player that came to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ back in the late 1800s. And he left professional baseball to become an evangelist and started preaching in Chicago. And while it tells us up here that the apostles said to pray to increase our faith, Billy Sunday said he realized when he read this scripture one day, that's how my faith increases, by the word of God. Billy said, I quit saying that prayer, Lord, increase my faith, and I started reading my Bible more. Because that's what the Bible told him to do. Amen?
Amen.
You see, beloved, we need to read the Bible not merely as a record of the past, but we need but as a revelation of what can happen in the present. And then we need to have faith, and we need to have a life of obedience. The next thing is use the faith that you have. Excuse me. Luke 17:6 says, so the Lord says, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be pulled up by the roots and be planted by the sea, and it would obey you. Beloved, your faith may not be great, may not be as good as it should be. However, it will become greater if you do what? You exercise that faith. Give the Lord a chance. Take Him in His word. Come taste and see that the Lord is good, ladies and gentlemen. Use that little bit of faith you got. Put it, exercise it. Put it into practice and see what the Lord does with it. He won't disappoint you. But make sure that you're using it. Our faith may not be as great as it should be. However, it will become greater if we use the faith that we do have. The next thing to increase our faith is to cling to the promises of God. The Bible claims so many promises of God. You know, we can develop a greater faith if we will find these promises and trust in them. You need to look for them in your life, ladies and gentlemen. You need to trust Him in it. You know, you need to look for those times. And one of the things I used to tell kids when I did youth ministry is, do you see Jesus? Have you seen Jesus today? And I used to say, because oftentimes we were at a camp or we were doing some Christian thing, I'd look at him and there'd be somebody that had just come along to help chaperone because that's what we needed for the day. Do you see Jesus in them? They're serving. They're not benefiting anything by, you know, they are getting a blessing by being with them. But they're doing that because God told them that they needed to be there that day. When we sat down at a restaurant, do you see Jesus today? There were servants all around, people bringing food to them, the fact that they had food and a blessing. You see, you and I ought to see Jesus all day long in our lives. And we ought to be showing people Jesus all day through our lives. Amen?
Amen.
Beloved, as God proves trustworthy, our faith in Him will increase, I'm telling you that, with the passing years. So start exercising it. Well, as we come to a conclusion tonight, I'd ask you to examine your faith. Make sure that it's not misplaced, that it is all in Jesus Christ. Are you putting confidence in something less than the living Lord who commanded the winds to cease and the blowing seas to cease their raging? If so, you will. I'm telling you, you'll be disappointed in this life. But if you have faith in Jesus, beloved, you will have joy, blessing, and life like you've never seen it before, and life eternal. Beloved, today we live by faith, not by sight. But in living by faith down here on this earth and trusting and loving our Lord, guess what? One day we'll no longer have to live by faith, will we? Because we're going to be inside of Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Let us pray. Dear gracious and heavenly Father, we thank You, Lord, so much for Your promises. We thank You that You will take somebody that has such even a little faith and work with it, Lord. Lord, we just ask that there be anybody out there that has no faith, Lord. We know You can't work with that. Just help them to come to a faith. Lord, we just ask that as we get ready to go out into the lost world, that we have faith to share the gospel this week, that we would proclaim it, that we would be bold in it, and that we would do what You command us, to have faith in You, Lord, for we know that You save and You save only, but You do want to use us to bring people to that saving knowledge. Lord, thank You for the privilege that You have done that. We now have a time of invitation. Lord, we just ask that You would have Your will and Your way with it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
75.
Take up your cross. Go out and find some way to tell somebody about Jesus and have enough faith to share the gospel with somebody. Pick somebody and just do it. The Lord will give you a blessing for it. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Rusty, will you close us in prayer?
Yes.